than the 7th. So, and it's still, it's a fifth Wednesday of the month. So it's still 4 weeks from tonight. So, but it'll be really great. And as in all our meetings, and especially tonight's meeting. And are you getting the feedback back there, honey? Because I'm hearing it here. Good old technical difficulties, but we're making it work. And hoping to do a walk on the 14th, which would be a week from this Sunday. But if we don't have any rain again, I mean, there are like no chanterelles. It's, there's no mushrooms at all, really, just except the little tiny things on sticks. Which little tiny hard things on sticks. Yes. Which, you know, it's not a bad category. We, in fact, walked today with our speaker, Jan, at Fernbank and saw this shirt there. Just got it at Fernbank today. And I'm calling it my Felinus Fernbank shirt. Because if you know the Felinus gilvus mushroom is that little shelf mushroom that's dark brown and very hard. And when you break it off and break it in half, the inside is the color of the shirt. It's that mustardy yellow. So, but we had a lovely time and actually got out before it was way too hot. And oh, and by the way, hi, I'm Sam Landis. I'm the treasurer and membership coordinator for the Mushroom Club of Georgia.
And I'm Cornelia Cho, the president.
And we have our treasurer or secretary here, Jeanette Hansen. And she's actually responsible for us getting Jan here because she had seen Jan speak at Paul Smith College in upstate New York in 2019 at the NAMA that I helped organize and said, that was a really good talk. We should have her come sometime. And it only took 5 years and one pandemic to get her here.
So, David, did you bring this, the meaty? Yes. David brought this new mushroom product. And it says, eat meaty. And I didn't get to ask you what you thought about eating it. It tastes like chicken. Right. It says mushroom root mycelium, less than 2% of salt, acacia gum, oat flour, and chickpea flour. Those are the only ingredients on here. So we'll send something out about this in our next newsletter.
Oh, it's from Sprouts. Okay. And besides being a mycologist, Jan is also a children's book author. And so she brought some of her books. And she's also the illustrator on many of them.
Two, three, which is a nature alphabet and counting book. So one of the things that's happened in the publishing industry is because they can print on demand, often these are, like you said, not in print. I guess, will you talk about your books a little bit during your talk or not? Okay, so I'm going to talk about them now.
And would you talk about them afterwards when people come up to you? Because she has some of these books actually for sale, as we'll get to your books on sale too.
I've got two books. I found a dead bird. And it's helping children understand the cycle of life and death. But my particular fun fact as I flip through this is that there are two vending machine deaths a year where people are trying to get in the vending machine and it falls on them. in North America. I love that fact. This one is called Before and After, and it shows changes that happen within a specific environment, and then has a lot of illustrations of different creatures and plants and fungi at different times. Yeah, different time intervals. And there is another book about the great auk, which unfortunately is extinct. And then I have, let's see, these straight here. I am Josephine, and I am a living thing. And you said you're pretty sure this one is still in print and available. So. Or connected and related, right? Okay, so she is selling some of the copies she has here and signing them. So if people are interested,
and we also have another book for sale today with the author here. So Lisa Frank, who is our longtime club member and has a new book out called Mycotown. And for some of us who were fortunate enough, we got to hear her being interviewed on which NPR show was it again? The City Lights, yes, WABE City Lights. But Lois Rice's host, but she was not the interviewer, correct? But and you very generously mentioned the club, so thank you. So you're welcome in it, and you'll recognize sites kind of sometime around Atlanta a little bit, and plants for sure around Atlanta, and it's a great myco-based fantasy book with nice mix of fantasy and reality and just the magic of fungi. And you'll be over here right after the meeting signing books and talking about your books too. So spoken like a real salesperson, that's great. Oh, yes. Thank you. On Monday, this past Monday at noon, the Black Mountain Myco Bash, which is the three club foray, which is replacing, which can never be replaced, but it's the Oconee foray that we used to do with all three clubs every year at Oconee State Park, that it became too prohibitive to do it there now. And then the pandemic hit, and the last time we did it at Oconee, I mean, we couldn't even use the kitchen area, or that we had to do it out in a barn and outside. So we are holding it in Black Mountain, North Carolina, at the YMCA Blue Ridge Assembly Conference Center. And it's the Asheville Club, AMC, Mushroom Club of Georgia, MCG, and the South Carolina Upstate Mycological Society, SCUMS. And there are still sites open. There are plenty of places open, not commuter anymore, but it's very reasonable to stay in, share a room with two beds. Very nice and great kitchen. We're going to be cooking together, great potluck, and it's going to rain by then, and we're going to find a lot of mushrooms. Yes. September 6th through 8th, it's Friday afternoon to a Sunday afternoon. And the guest mycologist identifiers will be Todd Elliott, who is one of the co-authors of the Mushrooms of Southeast, and Jay Justice, who is one of the authors of the Amanita book. So great chance to learn a lot and find some more mushrooms and get to meet people from the other, our sister clubs.
I actually remember getting introduced to more people that were into finding, cooking, and eating mushrooms in the other clubs than we had in our clubs originally. And I was so excited. It was so much fun. So people have different recipes, different ways of cooking stuff, different things they know how to find. It's really fun to meet people that are in other parts of the Southeast. Don't pass it up.
It's a deal. And it's a chance to do something that's, you know, within three and a half hours of here, rather than like NAMA this year in October is out near Mount Rainier. Wait. Sign up opened at noon on Monday. Yeah. No, NAMA opens on Monday the 8th. Our foray opened this past Monday. We know at least one or two other of our members who are going besides us. We should get going.
One thing that was rather sad. Our member Carmen Beggs, her husband Roger, actually perished in a plane crash. Some of you met them at the potluck, and anyway, was very sad to find out that that happened. Carmen has been helping us out a lot with the club and would usually be here, but this is understandable that she's not today. So, anyway, just hard when that happens. Yeah, it's a delayed feed or something. It's interesting. Okay, well, we'll find out what happens here. I get to see my... Sam is enjoying watching himself. Okay, so, oh, okay, we have time to edit it. So I do want to introduce Jan Thornhill. And as we said, because Jeanette went and heard her talk, often at these forays, there are several talks going on simultaneously. And then one of our things that we do at forays is we pay attention to who we like listening to and who we might want to invite. And we always try to make it worthwhile by having people come to at least Scums and MCG, and sometimes also Asheville Mushroom Club as well. And then we can also share the cost of bringing them, and that also works out really well. So, but Jeanette said she was a very fascinating speaker and talked about tiny mushrooms. And Jan will talk more about how she got interested in tiny mushrooms. Okay, and it's interesting, and I like your origin stories, and also, you know, how you got steered into whatever it is. And I also love that she's an artist and illustrator as well. And so it's a very interesting combination of qualities, and I'm really glad you're willing to come and speak to us. So I'm going to turn this over to you. And I know you've had fun with us so far, which I'm happy about. So yes, we can change the lights.
I have to hold it. How close? Closer than that. Okay. I don't like mics. But there's also a what is it called? A remote. That works. Where's the... Okay. Is the microphone necessary for the Zoom? But you normally need the mic for the Zoom? Yeah? Okay. Okay, so I'll point with this. Oh, there's a thing. Is there a... The center. Oh, look! Okay, the big world of tiny fungi. So my parents took me to journey to the center of the earth when I was 4 years old in 1959. And it's a very boring for the children, very boring movie until halfway through or three quarters of the way through, there are giant mushrooms and dinosaurs hiding behind them. And these emblazed themselves in my brain. And I've kind of been interested in mushrooms a little bit ever since. Oh, okay. Geez, you really have to have it close. It's like it wants to kiss me or something. anyway, I used to live in Toronto. And then we escaped in 1989. And in 1990, we built a house in the woods. We have 2.5 acres. There was about 300 acres across the road that someone else owned, but they were never there. So I treated it as my property. but then it got sold. Other people live there now, and they are horrible people who don't want me to look for mushrooms on their land. So I'm stuck with my 2.5 acres and a little bit of woods beside me that nobody cares about. And I just basically wanted to kill myself at first. But instead of doing that, I decided I will look for smaller things. Less area, small things. So I'm really into small things now. Why is this not doing anything now? Okay, I'll just say next. Okay. So that first picture is a twig I found I saw in the winter as I was walking up the path to my house from the creek at the bottom of the hill that I live on. And I just noticed these little smudges on the stick, and I just assumed that those were fungi because almost everything on sticks is either fungi or lichens. These are really tiny. This is probably in March, it looks like, because the snow has turned to ice, which is what happens as the thaw starts happening. Next. So that's the tip of my glove there, my finger. That's my dog's hair there. I have many, many pictures that my dog's hair show up on. She sheds like a constantly. Anyway, these are little tiny, tiny little cups. And next, close up. They're really pretty. So this is one of the, these look like ascomycetes, but they're actually basidios that have also evolved to make little tiny cups. They just look, Okay. Most gilled mushrooms are basidios. They produce their spores I never talk about them. I talk about ascos. The difference is in how they produce their spores. Anyway, these guys spend most of their time closed. They are one of a group of many mushrooms that grow high up in the trees on dead branches. And they are one of the things that make those dead branches break off the trees and fall to the ground, where they finish decaying the branches. But you can go out with binoculars when the leaves are off the trees and mushroom by looking up in the trees. A lot of the jelly fungi start way up there. Like you see them when they fall to the ground. But they don't colonize the branches on the ground. They're colonizing them way up there. And these little guys are one of the things that do that. It's a way that they evolved to get their spores to spread way farther because the air movement
It doesn't move so much down at the forest floor. Next. Live trees. Live trees lose branches all the time for whatever reason, but there's some of these fungi will colonize living branches and kill them, and others will just things happen up there in the trees and they don't get enough water, die. Next. Okay, so this is a tiny, tiny gild fungus mushroom. This is the only gild mushroom in this slideshow. It's Mycena acicula. It's very early spring mushroom where I I don't have these progressive need to see this. So mostly I use my camera to take a quick picture to see if something that I'm looking at is actually, and then I see that I can make a composition, but I don't see if it's clear until I get. Next. So a little from the top of spores. Next. I have seen it before. And it's a camel that decays fungi. And this one makes it really clear. That's what that's. They're a mushroom shape. I have no idea what mushroom that was. And it was Rhynchus spongiosum. Next. Yeah, they're like little cute little pom-poms, and they're yellow and orangey and white, depending on age, I think. But they're pretty cool and very tiny. Next. So I peeled back bark on logs. This was a. There's this white smudge. So this is probably at least a foot in diameter. And I went, that's got to be a mushroom of some kind. Next. And it's a little baby black. So that's a millimeter scale at the bottom. And I'll have quite a few of these slides. We'll have the millimeter scale. So these are immature. And they get about twice that size. Or sometimes a little bit larger, and they tend to have, they have stems. Next. And this is what I use to see things in the woods. My hand lens or a loop. I can't live without this. This was a ritual of changing the filthy ribbon once a year to a new ribbon, which I did before I came down here thinking there might be some mushrooms to look for, but I haven't used it. I have that around my neck most of the year, actually. Next. So this is the lachnum. They're almost always, they have these little guttation attached to the little hairs that are all over them. So this is when they're actively growing, they release water droplets. So they look like little tiny jewels. Next. And here's a whole bunch of them. They're growing on the outside and the inside of an acorn cap. Most of the things I'm showing you have no common names yet. They'll get common names soon enough on iNaturalist. People are making stuff up left and right. But it's not that they're uncommon. It's just that people mostly aren't looking for little tiny things. And because until the internet came around, it was really, really hard to identify them. Next. So this is
When I first found these, I thought, oh, that's another lacnum. They're a little white, they're hairy. They don't look like they have stems, though. And they're not really that white. They're sort of off-white. I should have put this the next to Tyla, Orbelia and Flatula. And the hairiness is actually asexual spores. So there's a lot of fungi will produce sexual spores, and then they also produce asexual ones in huge numbers that they don't combine genetic material from two places. So they're like, they make clones, but it's a way to stay alive. And these you don't see very often with the Canidia, but you could see them with your naked eye. These are small. They're only, you know, 2 or 3 millimeters wide, maybe up to 4, but you can actually see with your naked eye if you're 8 years old that they're these asexual spores. Next. This is what they normally look like. They're translucent, kind of off-white, and have it almost like a little rings inside them. Next. And these are the Canidia. You can usually recognize Canidia under the microscope. A lot of them are way bigger than regular spores. And they often are like these have, some of them have very long tails, and spores don't normally have tails. They just don't. And these ones are segmented. They're different sizes, irregular. And the spore of this little mushroom, the sexual spore, would be about a tenth of this size. So way smaller. Next. So there's a lot of these little cup things that grow on wood, on logs in particular. These are Melissia. Melissia, they tend to have lighter rims, and they're usually fairly opaque, and they're in kind of dull colors, sort of bluish gray, beige maybe, sometimes a bit yellow, but sort of a murky yellow. Next. And then there's Orbelias, and they tend to be in lots of different colors. So you can find mauve ones, and pink ones, yellow, orange. There's actually hundreds of them. There's a new book out, well, fairly new in Europe, that has more than 250 species named in it. And you can't identify them without a microscope. And even if you have a microscope, they're not... Oh, I shouldn't say this in public. they're kind of boring under the microscope compared to some other things. This one I named because its spores are a little special. Next. They're like bent in half. So most Orbelia have kind of little, they look like one of those, but stretched out. You have to measure them all. And measuring spores is kind of dull. Anyway, I kind of like those. Next. So I know you have, I'm pretty sure you have yellow fairy cups down here. This is a common little cup fungi that has a common name and has had a common name for a long time. It used to be called Bisporella citrina. That's the name in most field guides, but now it's gone back to Calasina. It's irritating because Bisporella is a much better name. I just like the sound of it better. And it's in all the books and it's in my head. Anyway, this one's fairly easy to identify because it's opaque, yellow, doesn't have a long stem, can have a tiny bit of a stem, grows on logs. But there are some lookalikes. At these little cups. I'm trying to think. And it's just saying hardwood in my head. But the, I mean, this one, the yellow fairy cups are totally promiscuous. They are not picky about who they're going to grow on and decay. And most of them are decaying mushrooms. Next. So this is one of the sort of lookalikes. It's Chlorosplidium chlora. They can be pretty yellow at one point in their lifespan, but they're a little bit more cup-like. They're a little thinner, and they have a tiny, they always have a bit of a green tinge to them, and that green gets more and more pronounced as they get older. Next. Now this one, Phaeohelodium, it looks almost exactly like Bisperella, except that it grows only on leaves. It does not grow on wood. But this is not the only Phaeohelodium. And you have to see them under the microscope to distinguish between them. Often. So epiphyllum, phylum is leaf, which helps. Like once you learn these little bits of the names. I should know more of that, but next. So this is, okay, on my property, I've lived there for 30 years and I have a little hill, it goes down to a wetland, and there's a sort of moist path that runs along the wetland beside it. And these yellow cups have been growing there forever, as far as I know. And I just didn't know much about these things early on. It took a while to figure out that, oh, the yellow fairy cups grow on wood, only on wood, okay. But I just assumed that, oh, there's some wood on the ground. That's all it is. I never bent down to look at them for the first 10 years of them showing up every year. And then finally, I got a bit more serious and went, well, maybe I should bend over and see if that's what those are, because it looks like they're growing on dirt. And in fact, it's something completely different. Next. It's Podophyllum xanthomelum. Xantho is yellow. And these look like little custard cup desserts. So they start out with this crusty covering as they're growing, and then as the spore-producing surface widens, it cracks that covering, and it breaks off, and you end up with a little bit on the edges. And next, and eventually, they just have a little rim of crust. They just look like dessert to me, but they're very small. And these show up every single year on this path and beside the path, just, you know, several thousand of them. Next. I'm pretty sure you've got blue stain cups here, the Chlorosaboria, or blue fairy cups. The really nice thing about these guys is that they have so much pigment in them and in their mycelium that they stain the wood the same color. Next. Now, usually the wood is really rotten when you find it blue, but once in a while, this was quite a hard stick still, and I got my husband to slice it with a bandsaw and got the screaming baby. I can't unsee it. Anyway, the blue is the spalt. It's called spalting. This the pigment that is left by the fungi. There's other fungi in this wood that have made the black spalting lines. They're kind of like fences, farmers' fences between neighbors. It's like, this is my area. So this is one fungus is in here. Decaying the wood, and it's keeping out the Chlorosaboria here with that line. So they just run all through the wood. And there's a researcher out west, Midwest? Yeah. Where's that?
Oregon.
In Oregon, yeah. Yeah. So she's been researching spalting and working on purposely getting wood spalted so that people can sell it to woodworkers. And using like crummy wood, like the wood that's no good for anybody else, because this spalted wood has been used for centuries by Europeans in art. So they use the blue as the water or sky behind the Virgin Mary and beautiful woodwork. The next thing I found this one, Patinellaria sanguinea. Sanguine is blood. So there's these really black little cups and this fuzziness around them. It has red, and then inside the wood it's red. It's kind of a really cool color. And millimeters. Yeah. Yeah, something like that. Oh, yeah, no, they're tiny. Tiny, tiny. This is why I look for dots. Anyway, this pigment is, like, there's so much pigment in each of these little cups that they look black. They totally look black. And I sent some of this to the researcher because I thought, red, but it wasn't going to work for some reason. I can't remember why. Next is this is what it looks like under the microscope. So you can see how much it's all pigment. It's just crazy inside. And so Ascomycetes, these long shapes are called asci, and the spores are produced inside them, and they are spit out of the top. Basically, this is a crush slide. I just crush everything to see what I've got. I'm completely self-taught with all of this. I'm a complete hack. I just have been doing it for a long time and have figured a lot of stuff out. The ASCI, ASCI. Like a single is an ascus. It can just be air movement. Like some of the cup fungi that grow on the ground or on wood, you can just blow on them, on the spore-bearing surface on the top, and count to one, two, and before three, click the camera, because it's going to look like smoke coming off it. Next. This is Catinella olivacea, olive for green. The top one up there has quite a bit of green on it. These guys often grow under bark, loose bark. So you sort of wonder how is the air movement going to make the spores move around? And mostly it's not going to. They're more dependent on little critters walking over them and just picking up spores on their millipede or centipede feet and carrying them elsewhere. But these have really nice little spores next that actually look like the outline of feet. Next, which makes me think of dance notation. So what I want to do is get a whole bunch of spore drops onto a slide and take pictures and then send them to a dance troupe and see what they do with them. Wouldn't that be great art? Next. So everything I've shown you so far, they're all wood decayers. This one is a decayer, but more importantly, it's a really vicious parasite that kills aspens where I live. That's a fairly large aspen, maybe a foot and a half in diameter. They're tiny little fungi. But they attack the living layer of the tree, and that's that. It's as bad as stripping the bark to a rabbit girthing a tree. Anchoelia prunosa. Next. That's what they look like when they're dry. So when it's not raining, they just look like a kind of a weird crust. But these are actually, each one is a little cup. And it's prunosa because of this kind of, it looks sort of hairy. It's not that hairy, it's more crusty. Next. And that's what they look like after you soak them in water for, I don't know, half an hour maybe. So it's kind of cool when after a rain, when there's like thousands of these little cups gleaming all over the fallen tree. Next. This is another character. This is how I found it. I had no idea what it was. I knew it was a fungus. Angelina rufescens. And each of these things has a little slit. And when they're rehydrated, next. Yeah, no, I think they look like some kind of fantastic British candy from the 1930s. But somebody said a couple of nights ago, no, they look like eye masks that you wear on an airplane or if you want to sleep after the sun comes up. They just seem really friendly to me for some reason. Angelina rufescens, so rufescens sort of is red. They kind of make the wood go a little red, but they also then sap the color out of the wood. They grow on oak. You can recognize this fungus from a distance because it makes really pale patches on the wood. Next. This a big old fir tree bed. I go mushrooming in the winter now that I know that there's fungi all through the winter that grow whenever the temperature goes just above freezing. All kinds of crust fungi and all kinds of little tiny things grow. They've evolved to do this because there's no bugs around to eat them. No slugs, no bugs. Yeah, there's some white dots there, right in there. I think I've circled them in the next slide. Yeah, that's where they are. And that was at eye level. And I went up with my loop and I went, well, it looks a little bit like little dots of mold, but yeah, it could be something. So I carved off a little piece and went home, soaked them in water, warmed them up next. And they're beautiful little Lactellula resinaria. Anybody guess what resinaria might refer to? Tree sap. They eat tree sap. They only grow on tree sap. This particular species, there's lots of them, and most of them grow on wood, but these are on sap only. So there's all these different substrates. Like you could, anything out in the woods, there are little things out there that are decaying them. Next, like these on the same piece, I found one of these and went, oh, that's completely different. They're even smaller. This was called Soraya resinaria because it also eats sap. Now it's called Zythia, which is, I think, a better name. Zythia resinaria, yeah, sounds like a dancer. This is incredibly common. I don't know about down here. I should have looked. The New York Club kind of realized that you could go up to any tree that had leaking sap and find these things. Next. So this is growing on goldenrod stems. So almost all the herbaceous plants have specific little cup-like things that decay them. Some of them are promiscuous and grow on lots of different things, and many, many of them only grow on one species of plant, or one genus anyway. This I finally figured out is a Pyrenopizaza, although I couldn't figure it out then when I found it probably 10 years ago. Next. This is what they look like close up, but they were too immature to give me any spores. So Without the spores, I couldn't even guess what they could be. And it wasn't until 2 years ago that I finally found them again and everywhere, like hundreds of twigs just covered. Next, please. And they all looked like this. And this was mature enough to give me spores, but it's not matching anything I can see anywhere in any description. So this part of the problem with the little things is that in North America, there haven't been enough people studying these things. People just sort of jumped on the European names, and it turns out that we have all different species. We have different species of plants, so why wouldn't we have different species of the fungi? Next. This is one of the promiscuous ones that it can be. Some of them are very specific. There's lots and lots of Hymenocyphus, one for every type of herbaceous plant, really. But then there's some that will grow on many, many different kinds. But they're not exciting under the microscope, as far as I'm concerned. I like to do easier identification. Next. So these are growing on leaves. In the spring, there's vernal pons, which are the pons that we get from the snowmelt. And they're really important ecological places because this is where our salamanders and salamanders lay their eggs, and little wood frogs. And there's all kinds of little fungi that like the wetness of the leaves. There's two species here. One of them might be a Hymenocyphus. I have no idea. I'm pretty sure it is, but the other one, I don't know what it is. I haven't identified either of them. They're just the mystery ascos. Next. Now this is a little hard thing growing on oak leaves. So this is made spalting. This is a little bit of spalting lines around them. Next, I think, has the name. They're called, how would you pronounce that? Coxomyces. Coronatus. Oh, Coronatus is the crown. So they look like little crowns when they're rehydrated. there's another one called Dentatus, Coxomyces dentatus, that is called the mat fungus. Find it on Oregon grape leaves out west, commonly. And it, the spalting, like, makes all these little amazing patterns on the leaves. But I like these little crown things. And next. So then there's the leaves of conifers, the needles. This is Lophodermium pinastri on white pine, I think. And again, there's spalting. You can see, so there's one fungus in this little area here. And then this is another fungus down here, another individual. And they're all divided by little spalting lines. And these, they decay the needles. And pretty well every conifer has its own species of these Lophodermium. So I found some on, what is your pine here called? Loblolly? Loblolly? That's a great name. Great name, Loblolly. So I found some up in Clemson that I gave to Julie just outside my hotel. Next. And they end up making photobombs in like lots of my close-up photographs. It's like, oh, there's that fungus again. And then there's pine cones. So there's things that decay pine cones, like this little pedicula here. Next. And there's these little black dots on a little spruce cone, which is about an inch and a half, 2 inches long. And I saw this in April down in my moist path by the swamp. It has kind of a weird bluish green tinge to it, which is what caught my eye. And I bent over and I went, oh, those look like, must be fungi. So I brought it home and crushed it and crushed one and looked at it under the microscope. Next. And they got pretty cool not sexual spores. I could tell they were asexual because they're joined together. That's not a thing that most regular spores will do. But I went, ooh, what is that? Next, the microscopy got even better. This is like an Escher print. And I managed to find a name, a European name for this fungus is Phragmotrichum chyleti I. And I wrote a blog. I have a blog called Weird and Wonderful Wild Mushrooms. And I wrote a blog post about it. And a researcher down in Florida contacted me and said he'd like to do some sequencing on it. Did I dry it? And I had, and I sent him the sample, but it didn't work. He got back to me, he said, can you find more? And I went, I don't know. I wait until April, and I went down the swamp in April and went, oh, there's some, dried them and sent them to him, and didn't hear anything for 6 years, didn't hear anything back from him. Okay. And then I looked the mushroom up on iNaturalist and found, oh my God, there's something called Phragmotrichum thorn ill eye without the H in the middle. And I went, that's a coincidence kind of thing, isn't it? And I looked it up and the paper was just published and he hadn't emailed me yet. Next, to tell me that he'd named it after me. No, it's funny because people have been, you know, they've been saying, oh, you're going to get a mushroom named after you for years. And I just tell them, oh, don't be silly. Anyway, it happened. So it's very thrilling. It was a typo that whoever sees what papers are published and immediately puts the name on iNad, he just missed the H. So I asked him to fix it and he did. So it's now properly on iNaturalist and yeah, thrilling. Okay. Next, please. So that's a little hard thing. And there's lots of little hard things, which is the kinds of things you can actually find in this kind of drought. this one's called Lasiosphera hirsuta. And they've got kind of cool spores. They're long and bent and quite large. And these spores are produced in ASI. The ascus is flask shaped. So it's like a teardrop really. And the spores are shot out the top part. So there's usually a little hole that the spores will come out of. Next, this one grows on logs and sometimes moves over onto fungi. So it's on a Trimedes here. Next, this is its sister, which is, you can see how tiny they are, but you see the little black dot in the middle, that is where the spores are shot out of. Next, this is called Lasiosphera ovina, after sheep, because they're white and woolly and kind of cute. And there is a lookalike. Next. It's not quite as round, and it might be a little smaller, but it's got the same black hole that the spores come out of. And this is a Nectariopsis candidens, and it's a parasite of dog vomit slime in particular, and a few other slime molds. Yes. What's it called? A cannon tuff? Olympus tuff? What's it called? Everybody uses it. It's a tuff camera. What's the company name? Yeah. Olympus. Yeah, it's Olympus tuff. You can shoot underwater with it. It's pretty lousy for doing distance, but its close-up is fantastic because it does what's called stacking. So it takes 35 pictures that are all have they're just like closer and closer and closer, so different parts are focused. And then you use there's a free app that you can use to put those photographs together on the computer. And that's what I've been using for the last 4 or 5 years, I guess. I love it. It's fantastic. It's like it was $500. They keep on adding, making it more expensive. Yes. Yeah. I've been using the Ring Light. Next. So these two guys that look a lot alike without looking in the microscope, the spores are completely different. So you can see instantly that you've got two different things. Next. This is another one of the hard ones. Carbon, they're called carbon fungi because they'll break your slide covers really easily if you're not careful. Hysterobrevium mori. I like these because they're like a herd of animals. A little looking down on them from above. And they have a little slit in them. So that little slit, when they're ripe and moist, they'll open just a little bit and the spores come out from there. And they have nice architectural spores as well. Next. Yeah, they look like, I don't know, chrysalises or something. Insecty. They look like they should be wiggling, but they don't. next. These are flask fungi too. So the flask part is buried under the wood, and then there's the hole, and it grows a little white collar around the hole. Stictus radiata, and they have vermiform spores, which means worm-shaped, so they're long and skinny. Next. And then there's a really weird one, schizoxylon elbow atrium. elbow is white, atrium must be around or something. These ones I call googly eyes. But I also think they look like licorice, all sorts, the bad ones that have the coconut on the outside, coconut candy, and then the black licorice on the inside. The ones that nobody eats first. Oh, you do? Next. And these ones, it's easier to call them not slime mold babies, because they look a lot like trichia, young trichia. Except they're not shiny and they won't squish and be slimy. They're sort of hard, a little bit hard, like hard jays, I guess. But they've got a little bit of fuzz on the outside of them. And they're quite tiny. These hairs here are the stems of spent chocolate tube slime. Next, they have, I took out that slide. Oh, now we're going to get to the sad stories. There's little white dots all over the place here, little white fuzzy dots, and that's woolly beach scale insect. These little tiny, tiny insects with white fuzz on top of them are able to damage little tiny, tiny bits of beach bark just enough that the spores of a terrible parasite get in. Next. It's called beach bark canker fungus, Neonectria vaginata. It's beautiful when they're making lots of fruiting bodies. But there, where I live, they're killing all of the beech trees. They're just, all of them are dying. And the ash borer is killing all of the ash trees. It's just, things are happening really fast and it's really kind of scary. Okay, next slide before I start crying. So now we're going to move to other substrates. Mosses have so many different parasites that, you know, there's people who their whole lives are centered on the parasites of mosses. This is one that I found. It grows north of me. So it's not a southern fungus at all. And the way you find it is you walk through the forest, you just look for logs with moss on them. And if there's a dead area, you go and look and see what's killing that moss. Because moss doesn't usually die unless somebody's killing it. It's a pretty little slightly pink cup. But there's also another really devious moss parasite next, called Eochronartium muscicola, which apparently is a rust, according to its name. But it grows, it looks like a little coral fungus, I guess, or a club fungus that grows out of the tips of the moss. Next, there's a whole lot of them here. It's a parasite, but it doesn't, it's not a really bad one. It doesn't really kill the moss. These little characters here on the stems are the fruiting bodies of moss, which produce spores as well in these little capsules here, in the sporophytes. And what these guys do is they trick the moss. They start growing from the tips, and they convince the moss that they are sporophytes. They mimic the chemicals of the sporophytes, and which say, feed me. And the mosses send all their energy to these little parasites. I think it's pretty clever. Next. Yeah, we are in the parasites. Okay, here's a parasite of insects. These are these attack the pupae of butterflies and moths that are inside rotting wood. Lots of moths bury their caterpillars will just burrow into wood to stay moist, to keep their chrysalis moist. And these ones, they produce asexual spores. So that's what the white, it's like white. You can just blow on it and it looks like flour flying off them. And this is the pupa there. Next, this one's a bit better known. This is the Cordyceps militaris. These little pimples all over the mushroom, they have a little hole at the top of each, so they're also shooting their spores out of those little parathecia. And this one, there's one chrysalis here, and there's another one pointed straight at us here. It's the only time I found a double. Next. Now this one is way smaller than the previous. The first time I found these, I thought it was a little, I don't know, it's a little kind of coral or club fungus growing out of it. And I went, oh no, it's got the little pimples. Look at that. That makes it an asco. It's probably a cordyceps. And it's an Ophiocordyceps variabilis. Next, and I peeled back the wood and found what I went, that's not a butterfly or moth chrysalis. I thought maybe, I don't know, beetle pupa or even a beetle larva. And it had this kind of pointed dark end here. And I went, well, that's weird. Next, it's actually the larva of a crane fly. The pointed part is her, this is the female, so that's her ovipositor. That's the part she sticks into the wood to lay her eggs. And the fungus just, it's so she has, that was a maggot you were looking at on the previous slide, which we normally think of as being white or cream colored, but the fungus dyes it that color for who knows what reason. It's a pretty nice looking fly. Next. And then there's this one. So this could be one of the first ones, the Cordyceps tenuipes or farinosa, that's just missing all its conidia, the white fluff. And there's a pupa here. But there was something about it. It's very flat. And I've sort of sent it around to a couple of people, and it needs to be sequenced because it could be another species. But I thought, okay, if it's a different Cordyceps, it might just be young, and if I keep it moist and protect it for a little while, maybe it will grow the little pimples that are going to produce the spores. And so I left it for a week or so, and then I went back next, and it was all moldy, and I went, oh no, I ruined it. And then I looked at it with my loupe, and went, oh, that's not mold. What are those little black things? This is cystosporoparasitic, which is a parasite of a parasite. That is a hyperparasite, which is something that made me extraordinarily happy. Yeah, parasites of parasites. What could be more exciting? Next, it's off for sequencing. I'm waiting for results. This is a slime mold, the coral slime mold, really, really common. Normally it's very white. Sometimes it's quite yellow, and this was the most yellow I'd seen. So I just snapped a picture of it and just for a record and got it home and looked at the photograph and went, oh, I missed something. This guy next. That's some kind of a fungus eating a little beetle, maybe a weevil. So we'll never know what kind it is because I didn't collect it and dry it to send it off to the people who will do sequencing these days for way less money than it used to cost. And we can all do it now. And there are there are mycoblitzes happening in North America. Every year now you can go out and collect fungi and dry them and send them off and they will sequence your collections, which is great. Next. This one is not a parasite, but this is something, okay, I thought I had found some little tiny Mycena mushrooms. I didn't even look at them. I just saw them on the forest floor and went, oh, maybe I'll have time to look at these Mycena. Took them home, was about to throw them out because I'd found other more interesting stuff. And then I went, oh, I'll look at it with the loop. And then noticed that the heads of them had powder and there were no gills. And I went, oh, that is not a little gilled mushroom. This is a feather stalkball, Onagena corvina. So these guys decay bird feathers and animal hair. And they can be found on owl pellets, which are when owls eat little animals and birds, they spit up what they can't digest and can find them and peel them apart and get little mouse skulls out of them and stuff. And there's another one that I've never found called Onagena equina, so after horses, and they grow on the shed hooves of horses and the shed horns of sheep. But that was a really cool find. It's really rare. Next. Also on leaves, this one was on leaves. I found it quite north of me, and it covered an area from about here to about here. And it was kind of, it looked almost from a distance as if somebody had spray painted orange in the middle of a very out of the way forest. It's moose country. I live in deer country, but 2 hours north of me, it's moose. And I went, well, it kind of looks like somebody peed and it's growing on the pee. Is that possible? Yes, it is. This is a mushroom that likes nitrogen and grows on places where there's urine. Isonectria. Next, this is what it looks like close up. Kind of nice, just gorgeous orange. Small, has a subiculum. That's the kind of fuzzy coating that it grows on. And there's another one that just depends on the shape of the spores. Next. And these ones I found at the base of a tree just around the corner from where I live. not in a park where you'd think a dog had lifted its leg, but you know, maybe somewhere where a raccoon had peed, I don't know. Next. Speaking of dogs, this is my dog Ruby. When she's 11 now, but this was during her first winter. and she's very offended by her own droppings and would carefully use her nose as a shovel to cover her poo with snow. So we didn't find a lot of them until the spring after the melt, and just went around with a shovel and threw them into the woods. But I missed one, and then a couple of weeks later I kind of glanced, I went, oh, there's another one that I missed, and I went, oh, there's dots on it. Next. What's going on there? I went, oh, that's something growing on there. That's really interesting. Because partly because dogs are omnivores, and omnivores and carnivores are omnivores like us, and carnivores like cats, and omnivores like dogs. Our droppings are generally decayed by bacteria. So I don't expect to find, which is great because it means I don't have to collect human poo and culture and look for fungi. Thank goodness. Anyway, I went, this has got to be some kind of a cup fungus, and it's too young to identify. So I didn't tell my husband, but I put a chunk into the house. And I kept it moist and warm like a pet for on the dining room table where we don't eat it because it's my dining room table now. It's the mushroom table. Next. And it eventually matured and I could identify it as Pseudomprophila porcina after pig. So yes, normally it is found on omnivore dung. Next, but there's another one as well, and it can grow on deer droppings. So then I start bringing, you know, there'd be a drought and no mushrooms out there. So what am I going to do? How am I going to get my fix of finding weird little things? Okay, well, you go out and start collecting deer droppings and whatever else you can find, moisten them, keep them in a little plastic box on a moist paper towel, and look at it with a loop every day, and find really cool stuff. This one I found outside. It was already well cultured by two different kinds of fungi. So one of them is the Pseudomprophila merderia. I don't know if any of you know French, but merde is a very common word in French. And then the other, so that's these ones that are kind of purplish. And then there's, these are the Ascobolus, all kinds of different Ascobolus. And the Ascobolus, you can see the little black dots on the cup. Those are the actual assi, or each ascus is black and pokes right up and you can kind of see them. Now, there's a lot of different fungi that decay herbivore dung. And this is a really good thing because we want the dung to disappear. there's some of them are will grow on almost anything, anything's dung, and some of them are very animal specific. And there's lots of people who study these fungi and they have conferences around the world. And they're, I don't know if they still do this, but they used to always have an auction at their annual conferences to where they auctioned off different types of animal dung. So somebody would have, you know, some dung from a zoo of some very rare animal, and people would go, I need some of that dung to take to the lab and see what I can culture from it. Next. Okay, so the spores of almost all of these dung-loving fungi, coprophiles, they have very thick walls, so they can survive going through the digestive tracts of the animal. So the whole way they have evolved is that they must be eaten by the animal, and then the animal defecates, they come out and they are already in their food, right? So it's pretty... It seems like the obvious way they should do it. so this is one that looks just like an eyelash cup that you find on wood, but it's a completely different species. Looks a little bit similar under the microscope. Next. This is a Chylomania stellatus, and the stellatus is star, and there's these beautiful little hairs that are diagnostic. So an easily identified one if you can look at it under the microscope. Next. Now, I'm a woman, and when I pee in the woods, I squat, which gets me really close to the ground. So that's when I look for little things. And I found this little rabbit pellet, and I went, oh, there's a little black thing sticking out of it. I wonder if those are fungi. And of course they are. They're ascos, so they have spores that shoot out the top, but their spores are pretty cool. Next. It's Prospera appendiculata, and here's the appendices, are these kind of mucousy tails on either end that are sticky. So these spores are shot out, and they're shot out at a bit of a distance, and they'll maybe hit a grass blade, and then the sticky parts, with the heavy part kind of swings, and the sticky parts twirl around and stick them to the leaf, and then another rabbit comes along and eats them. So it's better for them to be raised up than on the ground where there's nothing fresh to eat. Next. I don't know. I told you I'm a hack. I have a really good microscope I'm supposed to have a camera attached, and I'm supposed to be able to take beautiful pictures, but it's not working. So I just stick my camera, my pocket camera, my tough lens against the eyepiece and take the pictures. I'm just thinking this is probably, I think that's probably maybe 20. Yeah, I think so. Fairly large. Yeah, most of the dung spores are not tiny. Well, of these, that's not a general rule. Oh no. The ASCII is sometimes visible. Now this is a spherulobulus sphere and stellatus for star. So here's the star shape. These guys can grow on really rotten wood or on dung. This is what's called a spore packet. So that it's like a, if you've ever seen birds nest fungi, they've got a little spore packet too. So this is the spore packet, and this, it's kind of liquidy. There's all these different layers, and it's under great pressure. And when the spore packet is totally ripe, something triggers. So it's down here, and then it triggers this layer to evert suddenly, which shoots the spore, just like this. When I was down in Chile with Julia, we were in a horse and cow field, and I think it was just a horse field. Anyway, we found a pile of horse dung that was just covered in these things, and she showed us this great trick. Was she's going, okay, kneel down around it. We're all kneeling down around it, and she says, so they were all stuck to us. It was anyway, that was amazing. Anyway, these could go like, you know, 3 or 4 feet. They shoot off, and they'll grow on wood chips in people's gardens beside their paneling and their houses, and there's businesses that make lots of money by coming, getting called, because there's all these black polka dots all over people's walls that they want cleaned off. Next, here's the prints of the throwing of spore packets. So there's spore packets on the top here. These are palobolus, called dung cannons or hat throwers. And when, so they're under, there's a lot of pressure here. They're light, there's a light sensitive situation inside them, so that they aim towards light. You put your head near them, they'll shoot their little spore packets at your face. And they shoot them 6 to sometimes 8 or 9 feet away. And the importance of this is that this is on a big pile of horse manure. And all animals have something which is called the zone of repugnance. This is a technical term, and it's a zone around their own droppings and the droppings of their kind that they don't eat really close to the droppings. That's the zone of repugnance. They only eat outside the zone of repugnance. So these fungi have to get their spore packets out of that zone to be eaten. Some don't do it fast, and the dung disappears eventually, and then the spores are still viable. But these ones, when they shoot their spores packets, they are the fastest accelerating things in nature. But I mean, it only goes 8 feet. So, but it's kind of like throwing me throwing a bowling ball, like 9 kilometers. Yeah. It's really complicated, but I tried to explain it in a blog post. I'm not sure if I did a good job. Yes, there's water pressure under grape pressure, and there's this light sensitivity, and it all works together. Yeah, it's pretty cool. Next, are we running out of time? Okay, the last things I'm going to talk about are asexual fruiting bodies. So I've already talked about Canidia, the asexual spores, but some fungi have one form of themselves that makes their sexual spores, like Hawaia mucida, which makes these little black cups. And then they make another shape that produces the Canidia. Next. And this is, there's their Canidia. These are like black matchsticks with a little white goopy head that contains the Canidia. It used to be called Crinula caliciformis, but they've decided, the powers that be have decided that it's all of these mushrooms that make two different shapes and had two different names, because for, you know, hundreds of years, people could, they didn't know they were the same thing, that they were closely related. And they've decided to join the names into whichever was the first name used. But now it means that you can't look up, like, if you just want to see what the anamorph, the asexual form looks like. So there's the anamorph is the asexual, and the teleomorph is the sexual. If you want to just look up pictures on a Google image search, you're going to get them all. It's really irritating. I hope I haven't said I get irritated by too many things. Next. And then they grow on wood, right? And then I found these ones. I saw them on the ground and went, oh, what? That's weird. And then I realized that was a hairbrush that somebody discarded. next. Okay, I don't know if you have these. These are really common on poplars and aspen where I am, but I've found them down in Chile too, so I know they're cosmopolitan. And somebody the other day, next, there's a closer one. So they're kind of, they look like jellies, and they are jelly like, but they're really hard jelly, and they're a little bit slippery. But they're called, well, they're called Helicoglua compressa, but I saw somebody on Facebook called them fairy pimples. And I went, oh, yes, that is such a great name for them. So some of these things, this is an anamorph because it produces asexual spores. You can tell under the microscope that they're asexual. But we don't actually know what the teleomorph is. There's been some suggestion that they have a connection to eyelash cups, but I'm not sure about that yet. I think that's in the works. Next. And this one is another one where we don't know where the teleomorph is. We just know that it's in the Pisaceae,
area. So there's, you know, a lot of cup fungi, but there's other truffly things too. So, but these guys start out as little purple sea urchins, and then they blossom a little bit and turn into like little shower scrubber things, and then they. So these are forming the conidia, and the conidia turns brown, and then they just turn into these little brown ploofs. But they show up after, they like to show up after dry times. Like if there's been a drought, then it rains within 2 days, these guys will show up, and then within a couple of hours, they're all just brown mush. And they're hard to photograph. And I wish I knew who they went with. Next. Now there's a couple, this one and the next one. So these are just, all they are collections of conidia. So it just looks like, these are just little tiny spheres that you can see with a hand lens, that they're little tiny spheres, and they're just little piles of them that form. I've never seen them half mature. They're always like this. It's just like little piles of little tiny fish eggs. And they're, this is sparrow, so round, lignotile. And the next one is the Bactridium. These ones, these conidia are long and pointed. So you can actually see the shape of them without looking under the microscope. But I've got a little two comparisons anyway. Next. Yeah, so one is sort of round and the other one is long. And we have no idea what, there's all kinds of these things. Nobody has any idea whether anybody's ever seen the teleomorph or not. Next. This is a weird one. It's on the looks like a crazy little hedgehog creature, but the fungus underneath that this anamorph is growing on is probably, it was something like a crepidotus or maybe an oyster mushroom kind of thing that was all really decayed and curled up. And then this thing, these started growing on it. And it took me almost 10 years to get a name for that. Finally, just by accident, saw a picture with the name and went, yes. Because I used to end this show by saying, does anybody know what this is? But next. And these really pretty cup fungi. This is Botryotinia fucoliana, a.k.a. Botrytis cinerea. Okay, so these I found up north in bear country with the moose country. And we're pretty sure this is bear poo from the spring. And I found these in the fall. And in the spring, when bears come out of hibernation, the first thing they eat were, in my area, is the catkins of trees. So it's all plant matter in there. And it's from the spring. You can see because there's moss growing on it. And then these fabulous cups. And I found this the first time. I found it like three times. And I've sent it to a researcher at Harvard. And he, nothing happened until it finally got sequenced. Yay, it's sequenced. And it is the teleomorph of Botrytis cinerea. And it's very, very rarely seen. And the anamorph, the asexual form is next. Really, really, really common. It's this mold that grows on strawberries and other fruit. You've probably all seen it. Keep any fruit for long enough, it's going to grow this fungus. And that's the teleomorph of it, is this cups.
Well,
okay, so there's something called sclerodia that some fungi form, which is a hardened mycelium that can last for years. And the researcher had found in the sample I'd sent him that those cups had long stems that go in through the poo and
are attached to kind of a needle-like sclerodia that I would never have known to identify as such. But I've never seen any of these form such a thing. But net, if you should go to the next slide, this is the last thing I'm going to talk about. This is my vegetable garden in Ontario. I've been an organic gardener for more than 30 years. And I used to do a lot of seed saving and exchanging with the Heritage Seed Program. And I got into Next Heritage beans, which I love. They're so pretty and delicious. But you have to have a long enough growing season for the beans to dry on the plant enough to save them, which I was managing to do. But one of the other seed savers sent me beans that carried a fungus. Next, called white mold. That's its common name, Sclerotinia sclerotiorum. So that's the sclerodia are the hard. So it starts as like, it looks just like a white mold, but it turns bean stems to a slimy soup, really. And it's almost impossible for me to grow beans and save the seed. But I get my string beans. I get pounds and pounds of them before the plants are destroyed. But it's just, I have to keep buying seed, and I can't give other people seed of these kinds of beans. Next, so there's a sclerodium. And there's one there underneath the white mold. You can see the darkness, and then the white mold wears off. And then these things drop down to the soil, and they can survive in the soil, I bet, for hundreds of years. I would not be surprised. I've tried growing, you know, I immediately went, oh God, we'll have to grow the beans somewhere else, way over there. It doesn't matter. Wherever I grow them, I've got it forever. so this is like the bane of my existence until I understood that, oh, this is an anamorph. This is the asexual form of something, and it's the asexual form of a cut fungus. Where are the telomorphs then? So I've been looking for years, for I just check the soil every spring, looking for, there's got to be cups. One of these days, I'm going to find these cups. And finally, 2 years ago, next, before anything was growing, there was a little tiny, tiny cup. I found one. Next. And there it is, growing from the sclerodia. Anyway, I'm not so mad at it anymore. Anyway, that's my talk. I hope... Hope you enjoyed it. Does anybody have any other questions? Oh. Okay. I can repeat. I can try and talk in the microphone too. Yep. Well, I usually have little bead collecting boxes from the dollar store or tackle boxes to keep things separate, because I do dry things and catalog them, and I have a herbarium knife to cut things off. I mean, I often have to bring things home to try to get them to run. Like, some things will not have mature spores, and with ascomycetes, you really have to have mature spores to measure them. So I will keep them, you know, in a little, they call them moist chambers. I just call it a plastic container with, you know, a little piece of moist paper towel on the bottom. You just don't let them dry out. But that's, yeah, that's about it. Uh-huh. Well, I, pardon? Oh, how do I find the names of these things? Okay, so I started before the internet was useful and didn't have any names. Then the internet, I just started looking at pictures. I have a very good visual memory, so I sort of can go, I have seen that before. So there is a name out there somewhere. And then I started buying secondhand books of books that are out of print. There's a couple of books that are in print still, and I just sort of flip through them over and over again, but I sort of know where things are in those books now. And now there's a website in France called Asco France. There in Europe, there's a lot of people who are really, really serious about all these little tiny things. And they have a website. You can join it and send in questions, but you have to have measurements from the, they want some microscopy, or they won't take you seriously. And now there's iNaturalist, and you can kind of, if you start looking at pictures of ascomycetes and things that you might think, or Scutellinia, for instance, you can quickly find out who the experts are and actually ask them specific questions. There is a website in Canada. The French Canadians are way far advanced because they think they're European. And they are. I'm not being insulting. I have many friends there, but their website is their mushroom website called Myco-Quebec is absolutely essential for identifying for you know following through seriously with all kinds of things. They've got thousands of species and they have descriptions of every single one that they feature, and you just copy and paste into Google Translate because it's in French. What else? You go to conferences and start cozying up to the people who know what they're talking about. And you ask anybody like me, like you can email me and ask me a question. Everybody who is into this kind of stuff wants to talk about it. It's like with anything. Like I found that out when I was doing the kids' books, I needed to know if elephants, I wanted to have a picture of elephants, baby elephants holding the tail of the mother, baby elephant. And I wanted to know if they did that in the wild. I've seen it in circuses. Do they do it in the wild? And I was all really shy and didn't want to, what am I going to do? There's a zoo in Toronto and there's elephants and there's an elephant keeper. I think, get up the nerve to ask him this stupid question. So I called the elephant keeper, who talked my ear off for an hour and a half about elephants. And it was great. It's like, he loves elephants. He wants to talk about elephants. And I mean, that's true for pretty well anybody. Like people who don't like their jobs don't want to talk about it. But everybody else who likes them is their game. So ask people. Sorry, that was a long answer. Any other questions? No. Okay. Oh, you're welcome.
And don't forget, we've got Mycotown books over there. And then do you want to be back there with your children's books? So, you know, there's some kind of holiday coming up sometime, somewhere. So they'll make great gifts.
Didn't you have a date for the holiday potluck too?
It's going to be, I believe, Saturday, December 14th. Well, I have to look at my phone and calendar, but I know it would be a Saturday and it would be in you know, competition with all the other offices and everybody who have their holiday parties. But you heard here first, so go ahead and put it in your calendar for us. Yeah, Saturday, December 14th. Oh, and we actually have some more mushrooms from, thank you so much. Wow. From Green Box up in Gainesville. And oysters. So grab a few mushrooms to take home. And thank you very much. And those of you who can help put things away, we'll start doing that. Green Box, mushroom up in Gainesville. It's a Korean
Sure.